You're in the War Room, Jack Maxey, Jason Miller, Stephen K. Bannon, Raheem Kassam, and now joined by Dr. Alan Mendoza, the Executive Director of the Henry Jackson Society, a think tank in London. Full disclosure, where I used to work an odd decade ago. Dr. Mendoza knows all the trials and tribulations of trying to manage me. Alan, I saw yesterday the Henry Jackson Society pop this incredible new report, Breaking the China Supply Chain, How the Five Eyes Can Decouple from Strategic Dependency. Now, our audience is pretty clued up on all of this, but just as an introduction, Dr. Mendoza, why don't you introduce just very quickly the concept of Five Eyes and why particularly Five Eyes as it pertains to breaking the China supply chain and the strategic dependency rather than one of these other multilateral organizations that we hear so much of?
Well, good questions, Raheem, and a pleasure to be with you. And yes, you're always quite a handful to manage. Let's look at the concept firstly. The Five Eyes is, of course, an intelligence partnership. It trades intelligence data between five different powers. That's the USA, the UK, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. It's been going for many, many years. It started off as a UK-US thing and expanded beyond there. And it's, of course, a very key intelligence relationship because it enables our powers to share intelligence and each of them picks up, which might be of use to each other. So it's a way of, if you like, pooling our knowledge and being a force multiplier for each of the countries. Now, you may argue, you know, what would one particular country do compared to the US? Actually, I think the US would be the first to acknowledge that actually it's a very useful intelligence alliance. Now, why did we choose this as the basis for where to go? Well, part of it is because we're based in Britain, and of course, we are Brexiting from the European Union, have Brexited, although we're still in the transition phase. And for us, it's an interesting opportunity to look at some of our other relationships in the world and some of the other partnerships that may have, you know, been second fiddle during EU times, but which we now want to restore to the first order. Now that we're in the Brexit phase. And the Five Eyes obviously has a particular impact at the moment because of the whole Huawei issue, because we have, of course, especially in British politics and other countries have a similar discussion point about whether you should allow a company like Huawei into your critical network infrastructure. That links into the intelligence relationship. I've seen some to and fro between the US and UK on that. But we felt it was a helpful and useful starting point. We're not, by the way, excluding anyone else, but we think it's a great starting point to look at our five countries bonded by this intelligence partnership.
Dr. Mendoza, your report talks about the new aggressive nature of the where the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, is positioning itself as a result of the coronavirus pandemic. We've seen Larry Summers in the Financial Times today talking about how the this is the end effectively of the Western century. How this is we're now pivoting towards an Asian century. Can you talk to us a little bit about the aggressive nature that you discuss in the report and what exactly the strategic industries that you talk about are? What is a strategic industry and how are the Chinese becoming aggressive in those areas?
Well, it's a very good question, of course. Now, you know, in a sense, we're talking about the Asian century because, of course, the rise of certain Asian countries in the global system is, of course, something that we can all see. There's a very different place, the world in 2020, to what it was even in 1990. So we obviously understand that there are changes happening. But it's the nature of those changes and the country really driving that change, which is China, of course, that is concerning. Because unlike previous, if you like, disruptors to the global trading system. Japan was a good example of the 1980s. If you cast your mind back to the 80s, and I'm sure some of your colleagues will know this, there was a huge concern about Japan. But the concern was never about Japan's values or about Japan's fundamental support for the same democratic ideals that we have in the West, because, of course, Japan is a liberal democracy as well. So what we now face, of course, for the first time in many, many years, is a challenge to, if you like, the global system, the global order, by a country, China, which has a very different values system to ours. Equally, when you look to Japan, Japan was not trying to exert, if you like, global power in the way that China's been doing. We see in its neighborhood, China is aggressive to its neighbors. It seeks land from them. It seeks to subsume some of them, whether that is Hong Kong, away from its two systems, rule into a one system state. whether it is Taiwan, which of course it regards as not being an independent nation in terms of its approach to the world, or whether it is its seaborne disputes. China is being, of course, very, very aggressive in its approaches in different places. And what that means is that we have a strategic competitor. Yes, it's a trading partner. By the way, we used to trade with the Soviet Union back in the days when it was also a strategic competitor. But we always noted and knew that the Soviet Union did not have the same strategic interests as ours. And in fact, it was working to try and undermine what we were doing to promote what it was doing. Now, in a normal trading environment, we all know that countries cut corners. That happens. But again, there's a difference between what China's overall aim is and what democratic countries may do with one another. We're not looking to kneecap each other. But if you look at some of China's behavior in the past decade.
But Dr. Mendoza, aren't they at a hot information and economic war? Your analysis is terrific, and you see today the Commerce Department is taking on Huawei with components. But shouldn't we be more? How do you trade with somebody that's they're in a hot economic war with us, in a hot information war with us, in a hot cyber war with us? How do we sit here? Your paper's great, but are we on offense enough? How do we trade even with these guys? They've decoupled from us. They told us in the spring of 2019 they're coming up to all these different they're going to decouple from the West technologically because they say, hey, we can't be beholden to
Hayden Gray counter height, which is all.
But what if you already wear?
We're wrong. It wasn't the end of history. It's not the end of history. In fact, it's a cyclical history. We're now in a fourth turning. We have not finished the work of the 20th century, and that's because these atheistic, materialistic communists are absolutely adamantly juxtaposed and opposed to everything. We got Dr. Mendoza back.
We have Dr. Mendoza back. And Steve, you make a great point, and you took the words out of my mouth, even though when I'm talking to a fellow Brit, I'm a little bit more bashful about the way I present the questions. But Alan, that brings us on to the point that you raise in your report as well. Now, we'll talk about the strategic areas of dependency that you raise in the report. I also want to get into the polling and the public perception as well, because I think those are interesting. You have to have the people in the back of you to make this happen too. And we've noted from all of the great revolutions that have been taking place, that it's the people, right? You mentioned Brexit earlier. It's the people that are going to do this. But I want to bring up this particular point, Steve, and see if this resonates with you as well. You say on page 34 of the report, even Adam Smith, the father of free trade, made it clear that it was undesirable for a country to be dependent on its neighbors for military equipment, lest it become unable to protect itself due to reliance on foreign supplies. He wrote, it is of importance that the kingdom depend as little as possible upon its neighbors for the manufactures necessary for defense. Alan, these strategic areas you talk about, these are core critical areas of defense, are they not? This is not just about trade. This is about security, big time.
Absolutely. And you've correctly identified that the father of free trade himself recognized that there are limits to the process and that a country cannot lay itself completely to another country, even one, ironically, that could be an ally, because there are certain things you have to keep at home. If you look at what critical infrastructure is, there are sort of five big areas. Communications, energy, healthcare and public health, transportation systems, and water. If you start farming off bits of those, or indeed the entirety of those, to another country, you're essentially ceding control over a key critical national security component to somebody else. Now, that somebody else might be a friend today, but what if tomorrow there is an argument between your country and their country? What happens then? What if they turn around to you and say, well, we'll shut off your communications then. We'll shut off your energy. We will do X, Y, and Z. You have no recourse to defending your own people at that moment in time. That's something that Adam Smith was familiar with. We think that's something that everyone today needs to remember and be familiar with when they look at this relationship with China.
Dr. Mendoza, I want to thank you for how do people get access? We've got it up. We've got a link to the site. How do people get access to your Twitter feed and to the Henry Jackson Society website? We put it up. I don't want to have if people want to go directly there, how do they go there?
Very simple. It's www.henryjacksonsociety.org. That's the website. And the Twitter feed is at hjs_org. And you'll see all sorts of interesting bits to do with the paper and some of the polling there as well.
You guys are amazing. Scoop Jackson was a great American patriot and also believed in the Alliance, believed in the Judeo-Christian West. And you guys should be very proud. You're carrying on his work every day. Dr. Alan Mendoza, the executive director of the Henry Jackson Society in London. Thank you, sir. The one thing I want to bring about Adam Smith, and this is for all the Cato guys. Not only Adam Smith say you can't be beholden to your neighbors, not your, to your neighbors in defense. He also said the system doesn't work where one of the trading partners is a total mercantilist and a total mercantilist power. How did that get lost on AEI and Cato and everybody over the last 20 or 30 years?
Right.
All these apostles of free trade. When Trump first came on the scene and we started doing the populist economic nationalist thing, the blowback in the conservative movement was unbelievable. Oh, you guys are, you know, you're industrial policy guys. You're picking winners and losers. And we're saying that he's got to be free trade. Free trade, I said it years ago. It's a fetish, okay? It was not a policy. It's a dangerous policy because when you're against a totalitarian dictatorship that's a mercantilist power, what happens? Like in health security, you find out now you don't have PPE, you don't have personal protective equipment, right? And so the troops in this regard, the people crossing the beach at Normandy, the ventilator operators, the doctors, the nurses, the people taking the testing, guess what? They're the casualties because China, your enemy, has the PPE. They sucked it all up. And then they're going to sit there and go, hey, if you want to kowtow to us, we're going to bleed some of this stuff out.
So one of the reasons I wanted to highlight this report is in about a quarter of the categories of goods for all of the Five Eyes nations mentioned have critical national infrastructure implications. And Australia is dependent on China for 595 categories, New Zealand for 513, the US for 424, Canada for 367, and the UK for 229. And again, a quarter of those in each have critical national infrastructure implications.
When you're sitting at home with no job and no pension fund, and no football, and no Ramadan, Passover, and church. This is the reason. Back with Front National in a moment.